The Pleiadian Mission, A Time of Awareness. Part 6. 13,000 BC, Adam and Eve. The second in power to Arus was a mighty scientist named Semjasa. He and the other followers were under strict orders not to have sex or social interaction of any kind with the original Earth inhabitants, who were very underdeveloped and even genetically impaired from experiments performed on them by the Lyrans years ago. Keeping to himself, Semjasa defied the orders and worked in secret, performing his genetic mixtures with animals and the sub-developed Earth humans. He created many different forms of creatures and humans as he searched for a way to improve on man. In one experiment he mated an Earth female, called an Eva, with the higher evolved and older Lyran genetics, and created a more intelligent Earthman whom he called an Adam. In the Lyran language Adam simply meant Earth human, it was not his name. The Adam, by the way, was blonde, blue-eyed, and stood about 16 feet tall. The experiment worked so well that Semjasa tried it again and created another Adam, a female. Both of his Adams were great advancements in the human form and were more like the Lyrans than the Earth humans. As their intelligence and evolution had been greatly improved, he decided to keep them alive for study and kept their existence secret for many years. When they reached maturity, he mated the two Adams together. This was the beginning of the legend of Adam and Eve. The two Adams had a child called Seth, who became the firstborn son of the new human race on Earth. It had been 22 million years since the Lyrans had first used the Earth humans to create all manner of ape-like creatures, ruining the natural evolution of the Earth human, and now Semjasa had created the beginning of the wise and intelligent human race. It was his hope that he had been able to set things right and repair some of the damage caused by his ancestors so many years ago. Even though the natural evolution of Earth had been altered so many times, he had succeeded in giving Earthman a new chance to survive and grow. This was the birth of our current civilization as we know it. Some of the apes were created out of experiments mating man together with monkeys, and are not natural forms in creation. Arus and his band of terrorists continually started small wars around the planet, but these little skirmishes hardly had any impact on the great society of Atlantis and were not much of a bother for hundreds of years. Eventually Arus died, and his son Arus II continued to attack remote areas, taking control of what are now India, Pakistan, and Persia. They came in contact with the Sumerians, a peace-loving people who fled to the north for safety because they wanted nothing to do with the army created by Arus II. The Sumerians were tall, dark, and the descendants of the Syrians who first settled on Earth at the same time that Atlant started Atlantis. The Sumerians moved into the mountains and became an influence on the people living in India, Pakistan, and Iraq. The region they lived in was called Sumer and was a part of what is called ancient Mesopotamia. Later their ancestors would found cities known as Ur, Uruk, Kish, and Lagash, which have all become major archaeological sites in southern Iraq. The great knowledge of the Sumerians was handed down through the centuries and is preserved in pictographic and cuneiform writings that are still being examined today. The Sumerians are, for the most part, responsible for preserving the knowledge of life that was known during the time of Atlantis. India was then called Arya, and after a few centuries split from Arus II and made alliances with the great cities of Mu and Agartha. These small wars, which had no effect on the great power of Atlantis, lasted another 1500 years. Arus II grew old and was dying, but he succeeded in infiltrating his leaders into Atlantis and Mu, causing enough dissension to begin the talk of war. 9498 BC, the end of Atlantis and Mu. The cries of war caused panic, and by the thousands the people too took to their beam ships and fled to the Pleiades for safety. The war instruments of Atlantis and Mu were of very large size and power. The army of Atlantis contained 4.83 million fighters in large ships, plus 123,000 small, individual beam ships and 16,431 remote ships equipped with the most sophisticated heat-dissolving beams. They also had 24,230 medium-class ships which were armed with terrifying weapons. But even with all this power, Mu was superior in technology and boasted weapons of greater force. The scientists of Mu, knowing of the coming events, ordered a fleet out into space to search for a large asteroid in the debris of the destroyed planet of Melona. Finding it, they attached a powerful drive system to it so that it could be hurled at Earth as a weapon of destruction. As the attack of Atlantis started, the leaders of Mu ordered the giant asteroid to be launched, but it was too late to save Mu. The Atlantean fleet dissolved the city of Mu almost instantly. All traces of Mu were melted away, which is evident by the smooth, flat ground in the Gobi Desert where it once stood. The underground cities of Agartha were damaged and thousands were killed, but many survived the Great Holocaust. Rapidly, the giant asteroid was steered toward Earth, with a dedicated pilots attached to it. Propelled by the great technology of the scientists of Mu, the huge asteroid of death was racing at incredible speeds toward Earth when some of leaders and scientists of Atlantis detected the oncoming asteroid. They knew there was no way to stop it, so they fled into space, leaving the millions of inhabitants of Atlantis to die. The asteroid hit the atmosphere and burst like a supernova, generating heat of over 34,000 degrees. The asteroid exploded less than 110 miles up, and in 1,000 small pieces hit the Earth like a shotgun blast. The continent of Atlantis melted beneath the heat of the blast within seconds, and the floor of the Atlantic Ocean was broken, causing volcanoes to erupt and bringing the sea to a boil. Water from the ocean hurled upward to a height of 20 miles, causing a tidal wave over a mile high to rush over the landmass of Atlantis. It continued on across the area we call the Mediterranean and flooded northern Africa and the land of Egypt. By our current calendar, it was exactly the year 9498 BC, on June 6, when the great civilization of Atlantis sank beneath the ocean. The planet Earth rolled over on its axis, causing the seas to flow over the land, and volcanoes filled the air with smoke and fire. As the planet changed its axis and came to a rest in a slightly different orbit, the geography of Earth was forever changed. If you can picture the Earth as it is now, envision rolling the planet over until the state of Florida is where Greenland is now. That was the position Earth was in before the Great War. Florida used to be called Hyperborea and was the home of Arus and his warriors. The survivors of Hyperborea moved underground after the Great Holocaust and now live under Mount Shasta in California. The great continent of Atlantis, which was originally north of the equator, slid underwater and is now resting in the area of the Atlantic Ocean. From what I can ascertain from reading the contact notes, if you drew a line from Puerto Rico over to northern Africa, you would be outlining the northern border of where Atlantis was. This huge landmass formerly connected the continents of Africa and South America, but now is barely a memory. Remains of Atlantis can be found on the ocean floor off the west coast of the Bahamas in a small group of islands called the Bimini's. Here on the floor of the sea, oceanographers have discovered the remains of what appears to be an ancient city and have uncovered roads, walls, and other monuments which may tell the story of the last days of Atlantis. Also south of Puerto Rico, deep down under the water, you can find the tops of pyramids built by the Atlantean that still rise up through the ocean floor. This is all we have found so far to remind us of the greatest society that ever existed on Earth. 9448 BC, Jehovah controls the Earth. Soon after the War of Revenge by Arus II, he was murdered by his third-born son, Jehovah, who seized power over the Aryans and the other two remaining nations of life on Earth. The tremendous destruction caused by the asteroid hitting the Earth had left the atmosphere unbreathable on most parts of the planet, driving the survivors underground. It was 50 years before the air began to clear up and small tribes of people began to once again be seen on Earth. There were three basic groups of people left after the destruction: First Nation, the descendants of the Armis people who lived in the area known as Armenia since 33,000 years ago, they were immigrants from the Pleiades system. Second Nation, the scattered tribes of Persia, India, and Pakistan, who were known as the Aryans at that time. Third Nation, a worldwide spread of gypsies called Hebrews, which in the ancient language of the Pleiades was Herons. An Ishwish named Jehovah governed the three tribes until 7,000 years ago when he was murdered by his only son Jehave, who, like his father, called himself the creator of man. During this time, a group of 160,000 great Aryans deserted the rule of Jehave and wandered through the lands to the east, moving into the area between the Caspian Sea in northern Iran and Ararat Mountain in Turkey. This area was full of the descendants of the Sumerians, who led the local people with great discipline because of their highly developed knowledge of spiritual powers. The Aryans attacked and pressed the people into bondage and created a new state. Deprived of all technology, the Aryans soon began to mingle with the natives, and all previous talents and knowledge soon disappeared and were forgotten forever. It was only 1320 BC, when Jahave was murdered by his first son, Arasim, who had two sons named Salam and Ta. They were more peaceful in nature and stood up against Arasim, driving him and his followers out of power. Arasim did not have the power to fight back, for his followers were few and his technology was no match for the great armies commanded by his sons, so he secretly returned and hid in an underground city below the Giza Pyramid in Egypt. He made plans to take over the world by controlling the thoughts of world leaders and filling their minds with lies, deceit, and delusion. Meanwhile, Ta and Salam governed together and created peace until Ta was stricken by a disease and died in his 93rd year. This left Salam to rule until he became old and weak, turning the rule over to his son Pleiades in 40 BC. Pleiades was a peaceful ruler and had aligned himself with the High Council of the Pleiadian system. Arusim, meanwhile, had been governing his band of evil followers, called the Ba'fath, and hiding in Egypt since 1010 BC. He was taken over by a ruthless leader named Hin, whom the Hebrons called Heova. He was known as the Cruel One to his followers. In 80 BC, Hin was overthrown by a new leader named Kumagal I. He and his followers had to hide from the power of Pleiades, and were forced to continue living below ground under the Great Pyramid in Egypt. Their technology was failing and their lifespans dwindling. His son, Kumagal II, was even more ruthless than he was, and as soon as he was old enough, he challenged his father for power. After seizing control, he put his father in a deep, dark dungeon and left him there for years until he died. He was one of the last long-living leaders and would die in 1975, leaving 2,100 of his evil followers behind. By this time the Ba'fath, deprived of most of their technology, were controlling the minds of 723 Earth people through telepathic means, and these 723 represented their last hope for controlling Earth. 10 AD, the Pleiadians leave the Earth. 2,000 years ago, Pleiades, the last Pleiadian system leader on Earth, was informed of the peace agreement between the Pleiades system and the High Council of Andromeda. A new era of spiritual growth and peace had come to the Pleiades, causing Pleiades and his followers to want to return to their home system. It was decided to leave someone behind who could carry on the teachings of the creational knowledge taught by the Pleiadians. They would need an Earthman who was a leader among men and who could carry on the teachings of higher consciousness. This human was called Emmanuel. He was not born of Lyran descent, but as a very evolved spirit form capable of the highest order of spiritual understanding. It was arranged for Emmanuel to be procreated from a father of high evolution from the Pleiades, named Gabriel, and an earthwoman of Lyran descent, named Mary. As the Pleiadians had hoped, Emmanuel easily grasped the teachings of spirit and provided the foundation for what is today called Christianity. He lived for 115 years and brought the truth to all he could through his teachings. 74 years after his death in the year 189 AD, his name was changed to Jesus Christ, and his teachings were written down to form the religious teachings that prevail today. The Pleiadians draw our attention to the fact that we have spent more energy killing each other over Jesus than we have spent learning from his teachings. Pleiades and his followers had returned to the Pleiades and ended thousands of years of Pleiadian and Lyran influence. They would not return until 1685 AD. It had taken thousands of years of bloodshed before spiritual understanding had overtaken the material warriors and brought peace to the troubled Lyran spirit forms in the Pleiades. The Codex. Here on Earth still live the spirits of the first travelers to Earth, the 144,207 Lyrans who came here to escape the wars on their home planets. 2,000 of these old Lyrans were the leaders that were responsible for the abuse and experimentation of the original Earthmen. It was their conduct that set the pattern and leadership for the most decadent and immoral society yet to live on Earth. As their spirits passed away to the other side, they took with them a karmic, or spiritual, debt from the material life. Embedded deep within their spiritual consciousness and their Akashic records are the memories of their many violations of the laws of creation. Each time they have returned to material life, they live under what is called the Codex, a karmic debt that must be repaid. We are more than just material bodies with a consciousness. We are spiritual beings who go through a series of material lives in order to evolve through experiences learned during the material life. All spiritual beings are consciously connected to the creational energy, which is the true eternity of all things. Our spirits would not be able to have consciousness without the life force energy it receives from the creation or God force, as some call it. It is this life force energy, a kind of cosmic electrical force, which empowers the spirit so it can exist. It is this common connection to the creation that binds us all together spiritually. As each person thinks each thought, it carries like a ripple through creation and has some effect on all things. The creation itself is the spiritual energy of the universe. Each of us is a spirit form from that energy. Our connection is through a spiritual consciousness that can be sensed through meditation. All of our actions and thoughts then pass through our consciousness and go out into the universe through the spiritual consciousness. This is how we all contribute to the whole of the evolution of the creation. If our actions are of a violent nature, such as in murder, these actions affect the balance of the consciousness of creation. Our actions and thoughts do not simply dissipate or disappear, but are recorded in the ethers of the universe in what are called Akashic, or etheric, records and are a part of the spiritual being of creation. The actions and murderous deeds of the 2,000 leaders of the ancient Lyrans had an effect on creation and are recorded in the Akashic records of Earth. If you take the life of another through murder, then creation records this within the spiritual consciousness of the spirit form and keeps track of it as a debt owed. Let's say you murder someone through a violent act. Their spirit form then passes on to the other side while you live out your material life for another 10 years, and then your spirit form passes over to the other side as well. This action is recorded within your own Akashic record and the record of the one you killed. It has become part of the events of creation and cannot be undone. But since we are beings of energy, the debt can be repaid through the laws of energy which are ruled by creation. Here is how it works. Once you have murdered someone and you both have died, both of your spirits are on the other side and no longer in material form. The debt you owe can only be repaid in the material, so nothing will happen as a consequence of this action on the other side. However, once your spirit form and the spirit form of the one you murdered are both back in the material, the debt can be settled. It is not necessary that you know each other. It is only required that you both be in the material world at the same time. If the person who was murdered becomes ill or is suffering spiritually somehow and is in need of strength, he can take from the life force energy of the murderer to help himself. This is not a conscious act, for neither know each other or have any memory of the previous murder. They do not even have to be in the same area of the planet or in close proximity to one another. It is a natural function of energy in creation that moves life force energy from the murderer to the injured party. The victim will receive a flow of energy, which is taken from the life force of the murderer, and will start to feel better. The murderer, without knowing why, will suddenly lose some of his life force and perhaps become ill in some form. Since the debt is a spiritual one, it is not necessary that the material consciousness of either party have any idea of what is going on. The 2,000 Lyran leaders, who murdered and committed violent crimes of genetic engineering against their fellow man, have many spiritual debts to pay. Living a material life with a spiritual debt to pay is called living under the codex. It may be discovered by an individual through meditation, for the recordings of his thoughts are available in his Akashic record, a band of energy around the earth where all thoughts exist. As we are moving into the new age and the vibration level of the creational energies are increasing, most of the old Lyran spirits are coming back into material life. For some, there are many debts to pay. It is this codex which will silently move them to be the light workers of our new world, for they are driven to help out their fellow man and make a difference. Most will never know why they are driven or that they live under a codex. But by virtue of their older and more experienced spiritual selves, most will find themselves playing a part in the development of the new world. The Pleiadians are well aware of these old spirits and know that they can be awakened and can help to be a force for good in our society. They have allowed pictures of their beamships to be taken, which will stir feelings in some. Others will be slowly awakened by the teachings of creation and the understanding of spirit. The Pleiadians believe that if they provide the right teachings, the right words and ideas, the spiritual consciousness of thousands of old warriors can be slowly awakened. And if fed the knowledge of love and light, these beings can be brought to the front lines again to fight for a world that is sadly lacking in human understanding and spiritual knowledge. Having lived previous lives on worlds more advanced than ours, their accumulated spiritual wisdom will keep them from being easy prey to the illogical thinking which holds most Earthmen in spiritual stagnation. Theirs is the ability to rise above the common man and be the leaders of a new era. They are the visionaries, the creative thinkers, the scientists, the writers, and leaders who can envision a world greater than our own. Most of these old Lyrans have been prominent in history each time they have come into a material life. Since they have many more lifetimes and have accumulated much wisdom and experience, they will usually feel uncomfortable on Earth and try to change it. A sense of being out of place or in the wrong time is not unusual. Many may have visions of other worlds far more advanced than ours and long to leave here. During my visit to Switzerland, there was an occasion when I was visiting with one of the FIGU members about the Codex, and I was shown a book which recorded the lives of many of the old Lyran spirits. Each page provided the names and accomplishments of many different spiritual beings. As I looked through this book, I was surprised to see so many historic names. Truly, the old Lyrans have been working under the Codex for thousands of years. For better or worse, they always seem to make their mark in society in some way. The book went on to say that there were 5 different colonizations of Lyrans on Earth, some more violent than others. They had been the white seed that had forever changed the evolution of man on Earth. Currently, 2/3 of the white race on Earth is of the Lyran genetic as a result of these 5 colonizations. As I flipped through the pages of the book, most of the names were unfamiliar to me, but on one page there were the names of 12 different spirits listed. I didn't recognize any of the names. The page looked different from the others, so I had to ask about it. The names were of a special group of Lyrans who were now all in material life on Earth. The Pleiadians had given the names to Billy, and he was to watch out for these 12, for they would be drawn to him for reasons which were not explained to me. I was told that they believed that I was one of the 12, possibly number 4, based on the information I had given them about my dreams and my family background. Other considerations as to why they thought I was one of them were not explained to me. I inquired as to whether or not any of the other names had shown up, but was told they had not. As of 1987, so far I was the only one. The future of Earth. Through the awareness of how our current civilization came about, we can begin to see ourselves in a new light. The white race on Earth is not superior to other races, only older than most. If 2/3 of the white race is of the Lyran descent, then they have lived more material lifetimes than other races and have more of an obligation to be teachers and role models to those who are younger. As we learn more about our origins and our history, perhaps we can start to come together as one people, the people of Earth. It is easy to see, by the history of the Lyrans, that man has chosen the path of power and greed to guide his destiny, instead of the more spiritual path of love and understanding. Here on Earth are the spirits of these old Lyran warriors who are still playing a part in our development as a civilization. We can learn a great lesson from this legacy of history. Here we are again, a planet of diverse people whose leaders refuse to get along, but instead play a dangerous game of king on the mountain. Just as in the Lyran past, we are in a dangerous position where we have the technology to destroy our civilization, and it is in the hands of power-crazy men who are obsessed with a lust for control over others. The sickness of prejudice rules their thinking as they finance wars so that men can kill one another. If we are to have peace on Earth, we must rise up against the negative thinking that controls Earth. We must use the power of love and light to diffuse the anger and hostility that causes us to fight. I have always liked the expression, "Suppose they gave a war, and nobody showed up." If the teachers of the New Age can use the power of their light to show others how to live with unconditional love and balance in their lives, we can convince a lot of people to not show up. The answer lies in the knowledge that we are spiritual beings and are all connected together in creation. If we can see each other as spirits and not material beings of color and race, we can discover the spiritual bonding that will lead us to peace instead of war. Earth is moving into a time of spiritual awareness. As the high energy of the New Age takes its effect, more and more Earth people will begin to discover their spiritual selves and develop the powers of higher consciousness. As this event naturally happens, these spiritually aware people will provide the evidence that we are more than just material beings. Others will see that there is more to life than just the material existence, and a consciousness will develop to oppose the cries of war and hatred. For the first time in the development of our current civilization, there will be a more spiritual and peaceful solution to our problems than war. Earth will start to learn that we can all live together in peace if we shed the need for material power and greed. Real happiness in life does not come from the attainment of material possessions, but from the inner peace and love that is found on the spiritual path. At first, these spiritual arguments against war will be laughed at and disregarded by the powers that rule. Spiritual people will be regarded as unrealistic and crazy. But very quickly, within a few short years, we will see the tide shift as the people of Earth are drawn more to the spiritual way, which provides a way to live in peace and harmony. Eventually, over the next 100 years, the acceleration of higher energy will so dramatically change the consciousness of Earth that a whole new society will emerge that will forever change the way we live together. If, however, we do not learn from the history lesson given to us by the Pleiadians, we may become just one more chapter in the ongoing list of past civilizations that have destroyed themselves. The chronology of Earth history. This chart shows important moments in Earth history based on information from the Pleiadians. Dates are only estimates to show the chronology of events. 22 million BC, the first Lyrans come to Earth and colonize. 387,000 BC, 144,207 Lyrans come to Earth and settle here, forever changing the genetics of Earthman. 228,000 BC, a Lyran leader named Asael leads 360,000 Lyrans to a new home in the Pleiades. 226,000 BC, Asael dies and his daughter Pleia becomes ruler. The system is now called the Pleiades. 225,000 BC, Pleia scout ships discover Earth, and colonies are founded here and on Mars and Melona. 196,000 BC, war breaks out on Earth and its people are evacuated to the Pleiades. 40 years later, Melona destroys itself and becomes the asteroid belt. Mars is thrown out of orbit and all life is gone. 116,000 BC, for the past 80,000 years several small colonies have been tried by the Lyrans, mostly exiled criminals. 71,344 BC, the Great Pyramids are built in Egypt, China, and South America by Lyrans. 58,000 BC, the Great Plan. The Pleiadians build a great society on Earth that lasts for almost 10,000 years. 48,000 BC, Ishwish Pelagon comes to Earth and builds a wonderful society that lasts for around 10,000 years. 31,000 BC, Atlantis is founded by a man named Atlant, who comes with his people from the Barnard star system. 30,500 BC, the great city of Mu is founded by Mures, the father of Atlant's wife, Caryatidae. His empire is sometimes called Lemuria. 30,000 BC, the black race comes from Sirius. 16,000 BC, Arus is exiled from Earth for trying to start wars. He hides out with his followers in the Beta Centauri star system. 14,000 BC, Arus and his men return to Earth and settle in Hyperborea, which is the current location of Florida. 13,000 BC, the scientist Semjasa, the second in command to Arus, creates two Adams, who bear a child named Seth. This becomes the legend of Adam and Eve. 11,000 BC, Arus II attacks the Sumerians, who flee into the mountains. 11,000 BC, a group of ETs of unknown origin arrive, led by a leader named Viraco Koha, who controlled the city of Tiwanaku. His base was on an island named Mo. He provided the inhabitants of Easter Island the tools to build the strange statues there which represent him. 9500 BC, the Pleiadians caused the old spirit form from Lysen to come to Earth. 9498 BC, Atlantis and Mu destroy each other and ruin the planet. The air is not breathable for 50 years. All survivors are driven underground. 9448 BC, Jehovan, the third son of Arus II, takes over the three remaining tribes left on Earth and becomes the ruler. 8239 BC, the destroyer comet passes closely by Earth and causes the Atlantic Ocean to part. AD 104 BC, the Biblical Flood. 6000 BC, Venus is pulled out of its orbit around the planet Uranus by the destroyer comet and is in orbit around the Sun. 5981 BC, the destroyer comet comes close to Earth, causing great destruction. It also changes the orbit of Venus. 4930 BC, the destroyer comet once again passes close by Earth, causing tidal waves of destruction. 5000 BC, Jehave, the son of Jehovan, takes over rulership. 1500 BC, the destroyer comet passes by Earth, causing the Santorini volcano to erupt. It also pulls Venus into its current orbit around the Sun. 1320 BC, Jehave is murdered by his son, Arusum, who has two sons named Salem and Tah. 1010 BC, Arusum is driven out of power by his sons and hides out under the Great Pyramid with his followers. They call themselves the Baphath. 600 BC, Hin takes over from Arusum and rules the Baphath. Hin is called Heovah by the Hebrews. 568 BC, group of Andromedans come to Earth. They are responsible for the lines of Nazca. 80 BC, Hin is overthrown by Kamigal I. 40 BC, Salem turns over power to Puljos, his son, the last Pleiadian ruler on Earth. 10 AD, Puljos returns to the Pleiades after procreating the spirit form of Emmanuel to carry on the teachings of creation. 32 AD, Emmanuel is crucified on the cross. 115 AD, Emmanuel dies and is buried in Srinagar, India. He leaves three sons. 189 AD, Emmanuel's name is changed to Jesus Christ, and his teachings are rewritten to form Christianity. 1000 AD, Kamigal I is taken over by his son, Kamigal II, and imprisoned for life until he dies. 1937 AD, Kamigal II's second in command is called Arusik. He decides to leave on his own. He becomes known as Ashtar Sharon and tries to influence the people of Earth. 1937 AD, Edward Albert Meyer is born in Bullock, Switzerland. 1975 AD, the Pleiadians start physical contact with Edward Meyer. 2004 AD, possible conflict with an alien aggressor. 2255 AD, the year the Pleiadians predict the destroyer comet will return to Earth. This is the end of Part 6. For more information about the Pleiadian mission, please visit thepleiadianmission.com. Again, please visit thepleiadianmission.com. Also subscribe and share this video. Let the whole world know the truth. Thank you for listening. Remember that knowledge is power. Please, don't be left in the dark. Please continue to Part 7 in the next video.